In 2019, scientists from Canada and the US fitted 20 polar bears with recording devices in order to learn how these incredible creatures might adapt to longer summers and shrinking sea ice. The results offer a rare look at life in the changing Arctic through the eyes of a polar bear. I'm KP, a marine biologist who works with marine mammals. Recently, I began working with polar bears who are classified as marine mammals because they spend most of their lives on the Arctic Ocean, depending on sea ice for their food and habitat. But not all sea ice is the same. The way ice moves, melts, forms, varies from region to region. The dynamics are so different. Scientists from Polar Bears International have divided the bears' range into four distinct ecoregions: the Archipelago, Convergent, Divergent, and Seasonal Sea Ice Ecoregions. Spread across these four regions are 19 distinct polar bear populations. Two of these populations appear to be growing, four are likely stable, and three have seen significant loss in number of bears. The other 10 populations are a complete mystery. We know little to nothing about them, especially the bears in Arctic Russia. So let's start with the two populations that are decreasing in the seasonal sea ice ecoregion, because that's where scientists fitted the bears with cameras. This ecoregion is the southern tip of the polar bear range and features ice that disappears during the summer. When it does, the bears come ashore and wait for the ice to reform. The scientists were hoping that these cameras would reveal the different behavior strategies the bears use to survive their time on land while they don't have access to their primary prey. Before we get into it, I need to drop a content warning. We will be discussing the foraging behavior of polar bears. While I keep graphic content to a minimum, there are clips of predation. The cameras found that some bears simply laid down to rest and save energy by burning fewer calories. Others were actively foraging, eating berries, grasses, and even scavenging on antlers and bird eggs. Another swam for hundreds of miles in search of food. None of these methods worked. 19 of the 20 bears lost significant weight. On average, the bears lost a kilogram or 2.2 pounds per day, all because the sea ice is melting sooner and forming later, increasing the ice-free summer by 3 to 4 weeks since 1979. Back then, the average time polar bears spent on land was 107 days. In 2015, the average climbed to 130 days. Keep in mind that they're really unable to eat during these 130 days. A study published out of the University of Toronto found that the tipping point is 180 days. At that point, 21% of adult and 2/3 of subadult bears will starve to death. We know this because in the 70s, scientists formed the world's first polar bear treadmill so they could measure the energetics of polar bears and essentially learn what it costs to be a polar bear. They found that polar bears have an oxygen consumption rate over 2 times that of any other mammal. Today, we have more advanced methods of measuring their energetics. We've even been able to measure the energetics when they swim. And what we learned is that the energetic cost for these bears is even greater than previously thought. To pay this cost, polar bears are lipivores, meaning they primarily eat calorie-dense fat and blubber, which is why they have perfectly evolved over the past 500,000 years to prey on ringed and bearded seals, which they catch from a platform of sea ice. These seals will cut and maintain 10 to 15 breathing holes in the ice, and they'll keep these holes open all winter long. Every 5 to 15 minutes, they'll surface to breathe at one of these holes or at air pockets trapped underneath the ice. What a terrifying life. And then sometimes you pop up, you get nabbed by a polar bear. Damn it. Polar bears can smell these breathing holes from more than half a mile away. When they find one, they wait. Sometimes hours, sometimes days. When a seal surfaces, they're ready to strike. Polar bear heads are longer and more slender than other bears, so they can fit into these holes. Even their teeth are hyper-specialized for seals. They have a larger gap between their sharp front canines and the back molars. This is known as a diastema, and it acts like the hook to snag a seal. Their skulls have an elongated crest, the longest of any bear, and a lot of tendons and muscles attached to that crest, giving them the strength to pull a seal out of the water. Healthy adult polar bears will only eat the seal skin and blubber, leaving the carcass for scavengers such as ravens and Arctic foxes. One polar bear can eat 45 kilos or 100 pounds of seal blubber in a single sitting, providing about a week's worth of energy. Energy that they don't get when they're on land eating berries and eggs. One bird egg is just 50 to 90 kilocalories, while a seal is roughly 12,000 kilocalories. Meaning polar bears would need to eat tens of thousands of eggs to match the caloric intake of a single seal. A single polar bear can deplete an entire bird colony, going from nest to nest until all of the eggs are gone. At the same time, the bears are incredibly inefficient at this. Drone footage revealed that bears often waste precious energy just wandering around to empty nests because they can't tell whether or not the nests are full. This lack of calories also affects their reproductive rate. Adult female polar bears are having fewer cubs than was recorded at times when the sea ice was more available. Mother polar bears used to have 2 to 3 cubs in the 80s. They're now having just 1 or 2, and many of these juveniles no longer make it to adulthood. In 1980, there were 1,100 bears in this ecoregion. As of 2022, the population was measured at just over 600. That's almost a 50% decline, and it's getting worse. Based on an aerial survey in 2021, the population of polar bears in the seasonal sea ice ecoregion dropped by 27% in just 5 years. What about bears in the other ecoregions? Coastal Alaska, the Russian Arctic, Svalbard, and the Barents Sea make up the Divergent Sea Ice Ecoregion. Here, ice forms along the shore and the ocean currents push it into the polar basin. During the summer, these currents create a gap between the ice and the shoreline. As the Arctic warms, that gap gets bigger and bigger. Bears in this region are faced with a choice. Either come onto land and starve until the next sea ice season, or stay on the ice as it drifts into the polar basin. This choice is a lose-lose. Bears who stay on the ice are also probably starving because there aren't as many seals in the deep Arctic as there are near the coast. Bears in this region are considered the most vulnerable to climate change and sea ice decline. While two populations appear stable, the population in the southern Beaufort Sea dropped 40% between 2001 and 2010. As I mentioned, the other populations are extremely data deficient because they live in one of the most extreme and remote places on Earth. It lacks basic infrastructure like roads and airfields. We simply cannot get there to observe bears. Ice that drifts away from the Divergent region eventually piles up against the shores of northern Canada and Greenland in the Convergent ice ecoregion. This steady supply of ice has kept this region relatively stable and a good habitat for polar bears throughout the summer. The same is true for the archipelago ecoregion, which takes up the islands and channels of the Canadian Arctic Archipelago. Say Canadian Arctic Archipelago 3 times fast. These islands are very north and very cold. The ice here persists deep into the summer. The archipelago and the most northern parts of convergent ecoregions are considered to be the last refuge for polar bears. Sadly, the bears in the seasonal and divergent ecoregions can't just migrate to the convergent and archipelago because they simply aren't adapted to the way that ice moves and behaves there. So what can we do to help these populations that are declining? For starters, you can head up to this website right up here, Polar Bears International, a nonprofit conservation organization who helps endangered polar bears through research, education, and action programs. Another important thing we need to do is talk about this. Research shows that the vast majority of Americans are concerned about climate change, but they are self-silencing because they're convinced they're in the minority. If we can open up and get comfortable talking about climate change with friends and families, maybe we can start to turn the tide on this misconception and start mobilizing for change. And finally, we can vote. We can vote for politicians who at the very least acknowledge that climate change is man-made, and we can support those who pledge to do something about it. You can also share this video if you're not quite comfortable talking about it just yet.